the whole dark kind of hard rock era, there was more of the new wave. Pop was huge. You know, everything was coming together. Now, look who they were on the charts with in 1984 with Cyndi Lauper and, you know, Lionel Richie and Huey Lewis and Michael Jackson and Bruce Springsteen. It was such a hodgepodge of different styles. Everybody, you know, Tina Turner was pop and everything was pop. You know, like everything sort of became like a big amalgamation of all different styles of music going pop, you know. Lionel Richie was always R&B. Now he was pop. You know what I mean? And, you know, yeah. I guess Huey Lewis before could be considered sort of almost like a bar blues band. Now they were pop. You know, it's like everybody was falling into the pop category because it was the times. 1984 was, in my opinion, probably one of the biggest years for music. That was huge. What I also wanted to ask you, Paul, was Dave made it very clear that he was annoyed about Beat It. It really irked him. Wanted to ask you, do you think this opened the door for his justifying doing Crazy from the Heat? Because what really amazed me about Crazy from the Heat is you got David Lee Roth, the lead singer of Van Halen, is doing a solo EP with the producer of Van Halen, Ted Templeman, on Van Halen's label, Warner Brothers, all during the 1984 tour, and the band doesn't know this is going on? How is that possible?
Yeah, I mean, that to me is one of the most bizarre little sort of episodes of the band's history, but also in the sense of like Ted Templeman allowing it. I mean, obviously, again, you know, to credit Greg Renoff, he's done a, you know, fantastic bit with Templeman. You know, there was this sort of theory that, well, you know, Dave was only going to do sort of this kind of like cabaret, sort of, you know, good times, jazzy, bluesy kind of things, so and wasn't really going to interfere with Van Halen sort of brand. But to me, by that point, Van Halen had all the sort of already proved their sort of versatility, you know, particularly with the sort of Diver Down album. They had these sort of little diversions into, you know, old time rock and roll and sort of even obviously going as far back as Ice Cream Man on first record. But to me, those songs could have fitted onto the Van Halen record,
yeah,
without anybody being too outraged, you know, in the wake of Pretty Woman, in the wake of Ice Cream Man, in the wake of You Really Got Me. But I mean, obviously, there's a certain balancing act when you're, you know, at a label and you're sort of looking after the talent and you want to keep everybody happy. And, you know, I guess if Dave's coming there saying, look, I want to do this thing, and, you know, it's just a separate thing, it's just my own, you know, thing. We'll do it with some jazz guys and we'll, you know, we'll do it with some blues guys. It's going to be an addition to the story rather than sort of, you know, a subtraction or a diversion for anyone. But it does seem like a really curious sort of time to do it. It's one of those things, you've got to juggle balls in the air and you've got to make a call on it. But for them to allow it, you would have thought that, well, and obviously, you know, Ted Templeman and the guys who are incredibly astute and know what they're doing, you would think that they might have said, well, look, Dave, get this cycle out of the way. We're on a really hot streak. We don't need any distractions. Let's just cool your jets. We will do this. You know, Eddie's going to want some time off. Alex is going to want some time off. You know, there is space for you. We can block out 6 months where you can go do your thing. Now, we need you on the team. You know, you're the face of this band. Not only the face of this band, but you're the face of hard rock globally at the moment, you know. So it's going to kind of confuse people if you go off and do something, you know, left of center to what the band are doing. That, you know, I mean, I can understand how some of the others didn't know because they probably just didn't want to pay attention. You know, like Eddie's sort of gone on record and saying, like, I didn't listen to the words, you know, he was singing. And you could imagine he was sort of like just caught up in his own thing and wasn't really overly paying attention to what Dave was doing. And I guess had somebody come to him and said, look, Dave's thinking of doing a solo record, because of the Michael Jackson episode, he'd be like, well, I haven't really got a leg to stand on in terms of shutting it down, in terms of being like a big boss man going, no, you can't do that, because like, well, you just did it.
Well, it's very hard to put your foot down when your record company and your producer are backing the whole thing. I have a whole different perspective on it, Paul. The way I looked at it was, you know, when Ed built 5150, he really drew a line in the sand to counter Ted Templeman. And he had Don Landy, the engineer, on his side. To be honest with you, I think that Ted saw Van Halen falling apart during 1984. I think he knew that the ship could very well be sinking because deterioration between him and Don was breaking up. The deterioration between Ed and Dave was breaking up. And I thought that he used Crazy from the Heat as a little bit of a leverage because he didn't like the way Ed and Don made him look with 1984. As you well know from, you know, writing the book, you know, they played games. They missed the deadline to release the album. They were playing games with the master tapes. I think Ted was pissed. I gotta be honest. And I really think that it doesn't take much to stoke Dave's ego by saying, hey, why don't we do a little solo EP? Perhaps that was him testing the waters. Or was it to use as a tool to pressure Ed or to put him in check a little bit? There's something there. Have you ever seen anybody have a success with an EP like that in your life? I mean, it was crazy. So, I mean, he had these big videos.
Yes, yes.
He ended up on David Letterman. He's on the cover of Rolling Stone. Van Halen never made it to the cover of Rolling Stone at that time. He was a full-blown celebrity. He was hosting things on MTV by himself. He became his own brand. And I think that that went so haywire that, you know, it was almost like, hey, listen, all I need to do is put a fantastic band around Dave and we're ready to go. You know what I mean? Like, there's something there. Because,
yeah.
I mean, here you have a quote directly from Eddie. 1984 was me showing Ted how you make a Van Halen record. Now, what makes me wonder about that statement is, did Ted actually produce 1984, or was it really Don Landy and Eddie Van Halen, and Ted's name was put on it for contractual reasons? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's definitely the latter, isn't it? I mean, I think all accounts of the making of that record would suggest it's the latter. I mean, you know, I think Ted was there on sort of standby, I guess, to, you know, sort of sprinkle on the magic, you know, the final sort of little bit of magic dust that would give the audio tricks that the producers do. But I think, you know, it sort of wasn't needed. But that idea of sort of him throwing out, you know, the Crazy for the Heat EP as a sort of like a little, hey, you know, don't get too big for your boots, because there's two stars in this band and we can do this with you or without you to a certain degree. And I think if you were a betting man, if, you know, if you were a businessman in 1984 and at a record label and you could see, I mean, you know the tensions that are there because you've witnessed them firsthand. You know, you've been locked out of the studio, you've got Dave in your ear going, where are you? Why aren't you there? You know, whatever. So you know exactly what's going down. And if you were a betting man and to say, look, okay, we've got two choices here. Here, we can either go with the guy, regular guy, great musician, but essentially a band who want to be a hard rock band and are happy in that world, playing their own music, whatever. Or we've got this bona fide superstar who, you know, we can put up there against Madonna. We can put up there against, you know, whoever, like Springsteen, you know, in a different world. But this is someone who's going to be one of the five most recognizable faces, you know, in pop culture for the next 5 to 10 years. If push came to shove, I think it would be a brave individual indeed, or a brave businessman, who would have said, nah, you know what, I'm going to go with the Van Halen boys, you know,
yeah,
as opposed to, you know, the Diamond Dave Ross. I don't think anyone would have blamed Warners had they saw that coming and decided, if we're going to bet the farm on it, we're going with the solo guy.
Right. Yeah, that's incredible. And, you know, it's interesting. One thing I thought was really interesting in the book, in page 154 to 155, you talk about Van Halen's lackluster performance in Europe at the Monsters of Rock. What happened there? Why do you think that things broke down? Do you think it was because the band was almost broken up at that point? At that point, they already knew about Dave's solo EP and things were kind of sour. Do you think they were almost like in the stage of breaking up?
Yeah, I think undoubtedly. I must pay tribute to a friend of mine who literally passed away a few weeks ago, a writer called Malcolm Dome, who I think a lot of your listeners would probably recognize,
yes,
from the, you know, pages of Kerrang and Record Mirror, whatever. So Malcolm was one of the people I interviewed from the book, and he talked about going out to the 1984 show, or tour rather, and he was with a different band, his name escapes me at the moment. You know, in the dressing room, he could see that this was already, you know, a really, really divided band. There was no sort of camaraderie, there was no sense of fun between them. things were already very, very visibly, you know, broken. Yeah, so then, you know, the theory is literally as they were in the, you know, sort of waiting room for the lounge relative, you know, to fly out to Europe. And so you can imagine the sort of seething that goes on that transatlantic flight, sort of the somersaults that are going on in Eddie's head. And that wouldn't be resolved. Then you've got this show in England where there was undoubtedly like a huge excitement around Val Halen being there, but also it wasn't their show. And, you know, people should never underestimate the sort of popularity and the sort of draw of AC/DC, who were the headline band. I mean, nobody really blows AC/DC off stage ever. You know, they'd sort of lived there, they'd grown up there, they'd, you know, literally started from playing, you know, 50 people in bars in London through to headlining that festival. So they weren't ever going to be anybody's easy target to knock off. It's really intangible, the difference with the chemistry. I mean, it's hard for people, I think, who are not in sort of creative unions to kind of fully understand how a few little dents to the collective armor can really sort of affect the sort of mentality of a band and how that can sort of translate to a live performance. And you don't always necessarily even see it sort of manifesting itself, but the band themselves know. And sometimes, you know, when a show's not going your way, and I think Eddie had equipment problems, you know, on the day, and like monitor problems and stuff like that. And, you know, when you speak to musicians, you know, they know when everything's on fire and they know when it's not on fire. And, you know, minute by minute on stage, if things aren't going exactly how you see them, it does start to spiral down. I mean, people can watch, you know, watch footage from that show and sort of listen to the audio and think, well, this is an incredible show. I mean, what's anybody talking about? But then, I guess, seasoned watchers of the band will also know the difference between a 8 out of 10 show and a 10 out of 10 show. And certainly the guys on that stage know the difference as well. So, you know, I've talked to a lot of bands who have sort of been on tour knowing if they were breaking up, and it's sort of, it becomes a slog. It becomes, you know, you have to get through this. And there's a sort of real resentment sort of festering through it, a real sense of, let's get this over with. I want to get home. I want to get back to my girlfriend. I want to get back to my, you know, family. I don't need to be here with these people anymore. Yeah, I mean, you know, a tough time. And I say, you know, Noel Monk was talking about how, you know, the end of that tour, it was like, they were just tired. They just wanted to get out of there. And people forget how insanely crazy that sort of tour schedule was. We had a mention of, you know, something like 2 or 3 nights in the biggest venues in America. And I mean, it's obviously the amount of partying that's going on, the lack of sleep, it really is draining. And, you know, and you've got to be sort of the sparkling host night after night after night, which just purely on chemistry, when you start taking in substances and start taking in alcohol, I mean, a normal person, you try and do it for 2 nights in a row or 3 nights in a row, you know, by night 4, night 5, you're buckling.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
To multiply that by 130 shows.
Yeah, right.
You know, something will give.
That's true. And do you think Dave was actually planning to go solo, or do you think Ed made the first move by hiring Sammy? Because it's an interesting scenario. There is no clarity as to what exactly went down between Ed and Dave. If you listen to Pete Angelus, it was sort of agreed upon that they were going to take a break. Dave was going to do his movie during the break, and Ed was going to do whatever,
yeah.
And then Ed turned around and hired Sammy. So here's the thing. This is what's really suspicious, because I find this too unbelievable to believe. Everybody's got contracts. This is not some sort of clubhouse. I mean, you know, people have contracts with Warner Brothers. How is it possible that they could just remove Dave and just put Sammy in there? It seems a little tricky. Do you think that because Ted Templeman was not only their producer, but also an executive, a high-level executive, for that matter, in Warner Brothers, that he sort of brokered a deal a little bit? Because it seems like Ted was behind the scenes with this breakup, in the sense that, why is he calling Sammy Hagar and whispering in his ear that Roth has left Van Halen? It's a little weird. He has mentioned before that earlier in Van Halen's career, when he was doubting David Lee Roth, he was saying, yeah, maybe Sammy Hagar would be an idea, because he produced Montrose and he had a relationship with Sammy. He produced VOA in 1984, and Sammy was hot that year with I Can't Drive 55. Why is he calling Sammy and telling him private information like that? I almost feel like Ted was behind the scenes turning the wheels, because it seems like this whole story about Claudio Zampoli, here's Sammy's number, Ed going to the same mechanic. It just seems storybook to me, because there's a lot of business at hand. It seems like there's some sort of deal behind the scenes where Warner Brothers says, all right, this is what we're going to do. We'll bring in Sammy. Dave will have, we'll set up you up with a band. You'll do your solo thing, and then maybe we'll come back together or whatever. Like, it just seems a little strange. You know what I mean? All behind the scenes. This seems like there had to be some sort of deal that no one is ever going to talk about that happened behind the scenes. But it was a little weird the way it all went down. And to be honest with you, think about the times, 1984. You know, what was huge in 1984 was wrestling.